I know that I can only make change when I work with the existing government.
So you're not going in to antagonize any party.
No, you can't do anything with fighting each other all the time. Yeah. So, of course...
Or screwing each other in parliament, right?
Yeah. And I think the government also have the same goal as me. How to make life better for the people. Because they don't recognize that stay-at-home mother is...
It's a job role.
Yeah, it's an important part of the workforce of a country.
Oh, okay. So you're saying that there's not enough recognition given to stay-at-home mothers as recognizing their role as actually being an active part of the workforce of a country.
And I believe that I must have the authority with the people's backing.
Okay, with the mandate of the people.
To tell the government, look, you know, their issues, listen to me. Yeah, you know, I'm much older than most of the ministers.
Hey guys, and welcome to yet another episode of the Singaplex After Office Hours podcast. And today we have none other than Facebook legend, Mr. Tan Kin Lian. So how are you, Mr. Tan?
I'm fine. I'm glad to be here.
A lot of our followers, they have this question, which I think always relates, sadly in Singapore, it relates back to money, which is, aren't you afraid to lose your deposit again, as you did in the 2011 event?
2011 was not my time. 2023 may be my time.
Some people say that you're doing this for fun because you're very rich. What do you have to say to those people?
No, I actually do this not for fun. Many of my friends and the public said they want to have a contest, a real contest.
A real contest?
They don't want to have another walkover.
Walkover, right.
And they don't want to have a contest between two PAP-sponsored candidates.
Oh, sponsored candidates.
Okay. So therefore, I come in so that I can provide an alternative.
Choice.
A choice for these people.
But Mr. Tan, having been a leader yourself in corporate life as a CEO, you know that the odds are probably not in your favor. But why do you still decide to press on despite the fact that it seems very difficult?
From what many of my friends tell me, the mood in the country is for change.
For change?
Yes, definitely. They think that recently there were quite a number of, they call it scandal.
Scandals, within the naughty time in parliament.
Not only that, but also some possible corruption.
Allegedly, guys, very careful, allegedly.
So therefore they don't feel, they feel quite uneasy about what is going on.
Okay.
Growing number of people who think that maybe it's time to have a change. And the good way to have a change is to have a independent president.
And Mr. Tan, why would you say that you are an advocate for change? Or what's your stand and what are some of the beliefs that have led you to have this strong conviction to want to run for president?
Circumstances. You see, the rule, the qualification for an elected president from the private sector is very high.
Yes.
And most people would not meet it.
They don't qualify.
Even the 2011, the two candidates that got more votes than me, they don't qualify now.
At the current time, based on the current regulations.
That's right. The bar has been raised so high.
So
I happen to be the only one who still qualify.
Any of you all manage $500 million before? Something like that, right?
It's 17 billion.
17 billion, sorry. My politics is very ANC. I make memes, guys. The qualification is 17 billion.
No, I manage 17 billion.
Oh, he manages but the qualification, guys. Weird flex, but that's okay.
But the qualification is that the shareholder, the equity must be $500 million.
$500 million, which is $500 million.
Yeah, $500 million.
Okay, so I'm not that ill-advised, because I still know a bit of what's going on in politics, despite making memes all day. And Mr. Tan, would you say that some people, they argue that your corporate experience is not up to date? What do you have to say to these people?
Once you learned some principles, they remain with you for life. And those old wisdom, are much better than the new hype.
Fundamentals.
Yeah.
And having been in a leadership position over such a long period of time, what made you stay on in NTUC insurance for 30 years?
It is a mission.
A mission?
A mission. Because NTUC income is a cooperative society,
mm-hmm.
and our main task, the driving force, is how to meet the needs of
policyholders.
Therefore, I'm not the kind of person who says I must go to another place to earn more money. In a sense, I'm like a public servant.
Okay.
Means you earn enough, but you are doing something which is good for other people.
Other people. Mm. Some of our followers have asked, what were some of the challenges you faced over these 30 years that taught you some life lessons that maybe you want to share with the public?
I can't think of any because whatever is a big challenge, you need first to understand what the challenge is, and you need to work it out.
Okay.
You need to work it out. And after you found the solution, it doesn't become a challenge anymore.
So you're saying that actually the reason why you were able to steadfastly be in this position for more than 30 years, which is to people job hopping, that's a very long time, right? Is because you actually didn't view challenges as challenges.
It's just part of what you need to do from time to time. And sometimes the circumstances arrive and you have to respond.
Mm.
And you have to just respond in the best possible way because of whatever difficulty you face, other people also face.
Mm.
So it's a question of who is more patient, more enduring.
Mm. More enduring?
So I look upon these challenges as not being very major events.
So this is some real Zen-level advice for all of you people who are dealing with anxiety now in 2023. You know what, especially Mr. Tan, why I highlight this topic of anxiety and potentially mental health is because nowadays on the internet, it seems like the youth, the people of the internet today, they're very occupied and obsessed over feelings of anxiety, stress, inadequacy, cost of living, and in general, mental health issues that are plaguing society today. So what do you think are some of the things that have evolved in Singapore society that have led to this mental health crisis that we are seeing unfolding on the internet day by day?
I think the main reason is your own expectation.
If your own expectations
is high, then you want to get those things that you think are necessary.
Like a Bugatti.
And if you don't get it, then of course you feel...
crap.
Anxiety. Mm. And sometimes, because you get it and you can't pay for it, you got financial problem, that leads to anxiety.
Mm.
So I think for me, I've always been quite modest in what I spend on. I don't want to spend too much.
Mm.
And of course, some people will think that certain items are a must-have.
Mm.
I don't think so. I think it's not necessary. So I would be more stingy.
Stingy, yeah.
Shop.
We're Asian, stinginess is a good attribute.
So I would look for products that are reasonably good quality, but cheaper.
Cheaper. And when you mean by reasonably good quality, do you mean things from Taobao or Lazada and things like that?
I mean exactly that. Because they are very good Taobao. Quality. They're very good quality products online.
Yeah.
And you get you get information you can compare. And you can also get reviews.
Yes.
Occasionally, it will be a bad purchase.
Occasionally, occasionally there will be a risky purchase from Taobao.
But the amount is so small, it doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter, right? So right here on the Singaplex After Office Hours podcast, one of the life hacks Mr. Tan says is to always be looking at Taobao.
I look at Shopee.
Shopee, do you hear that? This is your chance to sponsor him right here. Right, this is your chance to sponsor a future presidential candidate right here. So, how do you think Singapore society has changed from the time you were in private sector to your retirement now?
I think one big driving force is that things are getting much more expensive now. Singapore used to be, when I was much younger, things were much cheaper. The last 20 years, things have gone to be too expensive.
It's crazy stuff.
I think that's no good.
And Taiwan cannot add fish.
That's why I wanted to enter into this election, because I hope to be able to advise, suggest to the government on things to bring down the cost of living. It's no good. We are now under some measurement the most expensive city in the world.
In the world.
And we used to be very low cost and very competitive. Now we are high cost. It's just no good. So I think that is something I wanted to
highlight.
Put some influence to bring down the cost of living.
But some people, they say that progress comes at the price of costs increasing across the board. What do you have to say to those people?
You don't have to be the most expensive in the world.
You don't have to be the most expensive in the world.
Yes, it does go. It does increase.
Yeah.
But it shouldn't be the most expensive in the world.
Yeah, yeah.
So that means if you're the most expensive, it means you are managing things not well.
I see. So it, in your view, it's about managing things to balance the stress. Okay. And so if you were elected president, Mr. Tan, what are some of the things that you would seek to implement to improve the lives of Singaporeans?
There are three main concerns. One is the cost of living.
Okay.
The second is the cost of housing.
Of course.
People are saying the house prices are keep on increasing, whether they can afford it. And the third is security of jobs.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
This mission is too important for me to allow you to jeopardize it. And I'm afraid that's something I cannot allow to happen.
Security of jobs, of course.
I don't like to see our young people don't get steady jobs, and they have to go and get
Grab food, Foodpanda. Right,
I think that's no good.
Okay, so with this, especially this gig economy thing is very big now, and there are some people that try, they boast that they can make $12,000 short term on like being a Grab driver and things like that. What message do you have to say to these people that claim they can make like 5 digits in the gig economy?
They represent a very small fraction.
Minority, right.
Yeah. And they have to work extremely hard at the expense of their health.
Indeed.
And I think that should not be the measurement. The measurement should be on everybody. What can we do to help the gig workers? There has to be some form of control, some form of licensing. You don't want to have too many people coming in. And then bringing down the prices.
We should make the current gig economy workers even more stressed and with lower hourly wages, right?
So there must be some form of control over some sort of licensing. In the past, not everybody can drive a taxi. There's only so many taxi licenses. So the same should apply to gig economy jobs. And of course, we also need to find new avenues for jobs. We are depending upon foreign workers because we wanted to pay very low wages. That is not good. And then your own people don't have a chance to get a good job.
Mm.
So all jobs must have a certain moderately adequate wages.
Okay.
Then you got a better society.
There's also the other side of the coin. Some people, they say that, oh, if we pay Singaporeans X amount of dollars, we can't compete. What do you have to say to such business owners?
Well, that's not true. Because if you suppress the wages, what happens is the profit goes up, the property prices go up. Because any business will have certain income.
Mm-hmm.
When you suppress the wages, the other components get more.
Okay.
So it's a matter of distribution. If you increase the wages, then the rental will not be so high.
And really?
Definitely.
Okay.
So therefore, countries that don't control this end up with high income disparity.
Okay.
Some people are very rich, and majority are struggling.
Okay.
Even America is in this condition.
Okay.
So therefore, if the government comes in and say, it's my responsibility to make sure there is a right balance, then you want to raise the wages, and you want to also manage that you don't have oversupply, and you don't want to have foreigners coming in to compete and bring down the prices. So I think that is, of course, philosophy of the government.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a good government will have a right balance to this.
I see. But Mr. Tan, why do you say that when profits go up, the cost of property increases? How is that related? Because some would argue that if they own the building, their cost of property remains the same.
The reason is this. When your wages are low and then your profit is high, so more people will say, I'm going to set up more businesses.
Mm-hmm.
And then the demand for the property is limited, so the rental goes up.
I see.
Because it takes time for new property to be developed.
So your concern is the speed of development?
My concern is that there should be a proper balance between wages and property and profit.
Mm.
And if you suppress wages, over time, the rental will go up, the property prices will go up.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I guess...
And this is not just in Singapore. I see this all over the world.
Okay, I guess this is a very deep financial topic that needs more nuances that we can't really get too deep into this during this podcast. Mr. Tan, what are some of your views on how the world is changing, like now with AI technology? Like maybe one day someone will do a fake video of you even. Maybe a fake video of you singing karaoke, but it's actually not you singing karaoke.
This is already happening.
Yes.
And it is a serious problem. When you have fake, right now I get on my social media, WhatsApp, things being sent around, and I say, no, it doesn't look right.
Yeah,
and you check, and it's actually fake.
Fake news.
Not only is it fake, but it's also malicious.
Malicious.
That means somebody purposely creates the fake and spread it.
Okay. Ill intent.
With ill intent, yes. And then other people were not aware, and they just continue to spread it.
The Matrix has attacked me.
Yeah.
So this is a very serious problem. And I think governments around the world have to deal with this. And the correct way to deal with this, I'm quite clear, is that people have to be registered. you want to...
People have to be registered.
If you want the right to send out content, you must be identified. You cannot create a fake account and then you
create... Like a user 123456.
And then... And nobody knows who you are. So I think that is not correct.
So actually your views are actually very in line with Meta CEO Mark Zuckerberg. Or at least his views when he first set up Facebook, that the world's moving towards verified identities.
Yes, I think that's a must. Yeah. And not only verified identity, you should not allow people to have many accounts. Many profiles.
Like fake profiles.
And it's abuse.
Yeah.
And the abuse is actually quite bad. It's gone out of control. Those social media is very useful. I use this all the time. And I am one person who I use my real name.
Yes, indeed.
My real telephone number. And that's me.
Yes.
Now, I have a page and I have a profile.
But that's both you.
No, but that's both me. Yes, and people can recognize it.
It's clearly identified that it's you.
I don't actually need two. I need only one. But Facebook says once I hit 1,000, I can't go anymore,
Happy first world problem, by the way.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
So therefore, I have to create a page that goes beyond 1,000.
Correct.
Otherwise, I'm happy to be in just on one account.
One account, right. Okay. So you're for the... in this world of AI, fake identities and online content that's questionable, you're for people to only be able to portray their real self on social media.
Right. Now, if you want to be in the world of imagination, then go into the
gaming.
No, not go into gaming. Gaming is fine. Then go into the movie. Then we know this. It is not real. It's just a story, then you go into that movie. But you shouldn't be doing this in the.
General,
in a space
social
where
media.
People trust that you are who you are. You know?
Having lived in the era before social media and now the current social media obsessed generation era we are living in, what would you say are some of the benefits of the time before social media that you wish current generations would not lose track of?
Well, actually, I find social media... quite useful. In the past, if I have to send a message to somebody, I have to write a letter, put in an envelope, and it arrives after a few days.
It's too long.
And it's too costly also. I just look at my drawer with my checkbook for my bank account. I have not used them for 5 years. All payment are now online.
Correct.
I know those are very useful.
But
the part that is not useful is this fake profile, creating fake news, and fake content spreading around. That's no good. And that has to be controlled. And if the government wants to control this, they will find me to be speaking in favor of it.
Favor of it, right? It's not that you're trying to be political for political sake. What at the core of who you are, Mr. Tan, from what I gather in our short time together here, is that you feel that you want to effect positive change.
Yes, and I think there's a thing called right and a thing called wrong.
She told me that with great power comes great responsibility. What? How do you know that?
Uncle Ben said it.
And what is right, you want to promote. And what is wrong, you want to discourage. So you must know what is right and what is wrong.
Especially nowadays, we live in a time of shades of grey, right, Mr. Tan?
It shouldn't be the case. There will be, in some instances, some grey. But most of the time, it should be quite clear.
Quite clear.
But I want to say this. Sometimes when there's a grey, not because people want to be grey, but it happened to be grey, don't suspect them unless the evidence is quite clear.
It's clear, right? Because now, will you say that we're in the culture of jumping to conclusions online?
Mm.
You see a post and it looks like this person is guilty or like, or this person should be crucified.
I experience this quite often.
Oh dear, okay.
They look at the topic, I take the trouble to write. They never read what I write, and they make comments, you know?
Yeah,
and I say, no, that's not correct. You're not being fair to me.
Yeah, yeah.
You're not being fair to the subject.
The subject.
I think people must take responsibility for making comments.
Comments.
And you must be polite to people. People take the trouble to write a point of view. You must read it before you comment.
Mm.
You must understand before you comment. You must understand before you comment. But many people don't read, they don't understand.
And they comment trash.
And they pass judgment.
Oh, passing judgment. So that's what you're against.
Yeah, that's very bad. Because it shows that therefore that you cannot
process.
When you accuse and you make judgment, that's very bad.
That's negative. In summary, what you're actually against is some people's inclination to post negative stuff because of prejudices that they themselves have inside. Actually.
And sometimes because of malice. Malicious.
They just want to create something negative.
So I said, if you want to have constructive discussion, you cannot be creating fear, uncertainty, doubt, distraction.
Distractions.
So if I put a particular topic, someone will comment on something else, you know?
Yes,
you are distracting. I think that's not fair.
Correct.
That's true. So I delete this comment. And after a while, if the people continue, if the author continue to behave in that way, I ban them.
Because this is my house, right? You will not stand for this kind of stuff on your own page.
Yes, I have the authority to... decide who
lives or dies.
Who comes to my place.
Yeah, that's true. Your house, right?
And I think they should be courteous to other people and to me.
Correct. It's like when you go to someone's house, you don't take a poop on the carpet, right? Correct. People who poop in Mr. Tan's carpet, bad people, you'll be out of the house, right? What do you say to people that... they seem to have too much time on their hands. All they do is go to people's pages and post negative stuff without taking into context the what you said, the entire issue at hand that you have talked about.
If they have too much time on their hands, I encourage them to go to the movie theater. That's a better place.
To spend their time to look at stories.
Go and play mahjong with your friends.
Be entertained elsewhere. Not on your page, right? Not your page. And
I want to say something about what the young people need.
Oh, okay.
Especially when it comes to this presidential election.
Okay.
They want to see who should I vote for,
mm.
And what is it that the candidate would make exciting for me.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. So I've been thinking about this, and I said, for most young people, the most important is you must have job security, you must have low cost of living.
Mm.
So those are the important things. And I'm not the kind of person who can entertain them. People like Jonathan can entertain them better.
I try, guys.
No, so I say, for young people, they should therefore look for who can help create the environment that they can live a good life.
And yet, voila, bon appétit. I missed you, baby sweet. Was a day, huh?
It was a day.
Would you read to me?
Harmonious living.
Yeah, you can. They have financial security, and then if they want entertainment, there are plenty of people. Not me.
So you're saying that for young people who are going to vote soon, they should look at the candidate that can give them, hopefully, an environment of
something in the future they can look forward
continued
to.
Continued stability.
Job security.
Yeah, job security.
And growth. Right. I think that's important. Yeah.
And there are some people that say that with technology like AI.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
And I'm afraid that's something I cannot allow to happen.
ChatGPT, blockchain, and all these emerging technologies, they are here now and are here, clearly here to stay. That job security will no longer be guaranteed, and how do you think we can all face this challenge as a nation?
The impact is exaggerated.
Exaggerated.
With every change, it creates new opportunity.
Mm.
For example, I'm now helping. Okay, this is part of my business. I'm still running a business in computer software development, and I'm now looking at robots for providing service in restaurants.
So
the robot will not replace the waiter.
Mm.
The robot will help the waiter,
mm.
because right now in the restaurant, the waiter has to run to the kitchen, carry the thing back and forth.
Yes.
That transportation can be done by the robot.
Mm.
And then the robot come nearby and the waiter can take the plates to the table.
Like in Hai Di Lao.
Like that.
Something like that. Right.
And this could apply widely to many restaurants.
Mm.
So you have robots that can provide the transportation.
Mm-hmm.
And human beings are still...
the last mile of service.
Yeah. Right. The last few feet.
Service. And some people... would definitely be curious, Mr. Tan, how your robot is different from Hai Di Lao's robot.
It is the same.
It's the same.
But it's the concept.
It's the concept, right? Yeah. And because Hai Di Lao, that robot is patented to their restaurant, right? You want to create a robot that can
be more general.
Be more general for all kinds of F&B.
Yeah.
I see. And why do you why are you keen to actually still? You know, some people would say at the age of 75, you should be relaxing by the beach. I mean, that's a cliche, but you know, nowadays it's all about the beach.
I'll beach off with you any day, Ken.
Let's beach off.
Right? And then taking it easy in your golden years. What have you got to say to these people? Why do you still choose to be so engaged with Singaporean society?
You look at me. And so most people will not know that I'm 75.
I haven't been human for 200 years.
Yes, indeed. You look actually quite healthy and vibrant for your age.
Yeah, and the main reason is I keep my mind active.
Mm.
And I also keep my body active. So I do exercise regularly, and so I think I don't I think it's good to be active.
Active.
And right. The mind, the body. Yeah. So the idea that you can take things easy.
It's never the case, right? So if you take things too easy, your whole mind and body will rot and you will never be active, guys. Yeah. Active SG. Right. So Mr. Tan, what do you think about the new Barbie movie? That's trending on the internet.
I leave it to my grandchildren.
Your grandchildren, right? Are they too young to watch the Barbie movie?
I don't know who it's targeted for.
Okay, okay.
But I believe it's for maybe teenagers.
Teenagers, right, yeah. And then have you watched the latest Oppenheimer movie about the atomic bomb?
I have not.
No. You have not, right?
So I got other things to watch.
Watch, right? like for example, we want to know why Mr. Tan watching.
I keep track of politics.
Global politics. Global.
Geopolitical tension between countries.
Tension, yeah.
Between
yeah.
countries. I look at political systems.
Political systems.
And most people think that democracy is the wonderful thing.
Uh-huh.
I don't.
You don't?
I don't.
Guys, this is a serious point in the podcast. Okay, Mr. Tan, why do you not believe in democracy?
I find in most countries, democracy end up with political parties attacking each other and they're not paying attention to solving the problem of the country.
So you're saying they're not actually solving the problem but rather playing politics?
Fake news. They're playing politics. And that's what I see all over.
The whole world, especially.
Most parts of the world. And I think that's not good.
So
the world has got problems to solve. And you spend your time just attacking each other, obstructing each other.
You will not solve anything. No. Right?
So even for me, even if I want to enter the presidential contest, I know that I can only make change when I work with the existing government.
So you're not going in to antagonize any party.
You can't do anything with fighting each other all the time. Yeah. So. Of course,
or screwing each other in parliament.
Of course, it's quite important that we have the same goal, and I think the government also have the same goal as me: how to make life better for the people. But their approach, I know that I can only make change when I work with the existing government.
So you're not going in to antagonize any party.
You can't do anything with fighting each other all the time. So. Of course.
Or screwing each other in parliament.
Of course, it's quite important that we have the same goal. And I think the government also have the same goal as me. How to make life better for the people. And I believe that I must have the authority with the people's backing.
Okay, with the mandate of the people.
To tell the government, look, you know, there are listen issues? To me. Yeah, you know, yeah. I'm much older than most of the ministers. They should be open to think about those changes. Cannot be just continue what they have been continuing before. Or even if they make minor adjustments, you're not solving the roots of the problem.
Oh, you're saying that minor adjustments do not solve the root issues that are facing our country.
That's right.
Okay.
And one of the problems that I didn't raise, but has been with us for 50 years.
50?
Is the declining birth rate. And it's largely driven by the social economic system. People are saying
it's too expensive.
It's too expensive.
To screw around. No.
So I think that's another very big problem. Of course, the excuse is it also happened in other countries. I say, true. But we are worse than most of them.
We'll be right back.
that's right. We have the lowest sex life in all of Asia. People are too busy and too expensive to screw around. Mm. Right now, this is costly. Mr. Tan, this topic of like birth rate, you know, is very contentious and very touchy, right? So if you are a young person living today faced with all these financial pressures, how would you actually, would you even want to like procreate if you're so stressed? Like,
I would encourage people to, I said earlier, don't overspend.
Mm-hmm.
Have modest expectation.
Yes.
Then you will have some money to take care of children.
Uh-huh. Okay.
But if you are spending too much and you got not enough money,
yes, of course,
then your children become a big burden.
Yes, it is.
Even when when I started as the CEO of insurance of NTUC Income,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
my salary was not high.
It wasn't high?
It wasn't high.
What, can you share what was your salary back then?
My starting salary in 1977 was $3,000.
In 1977?
Yeah.
Guys, some people, $3,000 now cannot survive. But of course, that's inflation.
It was enough for me
Because
I stayed in a HDB flat.
Mm-hmm.
And the HDB flat provided by Lee Kuan Yew, Goh Keng Swee at that time,
the first of HDB.
They were quite...
Quite low. The prices were low.
They're quite low. Yeah. So that's enough for most people to get by.
Mm-hmm.
My wife didn't work.
Mm-hmm. Your wife didn't work,
Didn't work. So
a true luxury, you guys.
Our needs were quite modest. We don't overspend.
No Bugattis, guys.
I hope that more people will choose this style. Choose his lifestyle, and you can raise children, and I can tell you, raising children is quite wonderful.
But there's also another camp, and we must try to address all these different viewpoints, Mr. Tan. Some people are totally not interested in having children. It's not a lack of money, because some of them, if you see the income census, right, they actually earn way above 5 digits. They also don't seem to be spending a lot of money. They rather invest in, you know, stocks or crypto
or property.
Or property, or they are trying to what they call FIRE, which is financial independence, retire early. So what do you say to it could even not be related to finance, they just don't like the idea of having children. What do you have to say to these people?
That's fine. That's their choice. But then look at the other people.
Mm-hmm. There is the other people that may have the interest.
They have the interest. And this is why I disagree with the government policy for 5 decades.
5 decades?
50 years.
Mm.
All the way to 1983.
For the uninitiated, Mr. Tan, what was this specific policy?
The policy at that time, mistaken policy was we want to encourage graduate women to have more children.
Yes.
And they even went to penalize the non-graduate woman.
How did they penalize the non-graduate
woman? The incentive is given more to the graduate mothers.
Oh, really?
So therefore, the non-graduate mothers don't get the incentive, and already raising children are quite expensive.
Difficult, right?
Yeah. There was a mistaken policy. Now, my view is this. Within any cohort of people, there will be maybe 50% or maybe 30 to 50% who would prefer to be career-minded.
Mm, of course. Yeah.
But there's another 50% who would be happy to be homemakers.
Okay, okay.
My mother was a homemaker.
Yep.
All her generation, everybody was a homemaker.
Okay.
When it comes to my wife, she's a homemaker.
Okay.
And within my generation, about 50% are homemakers.
Okay.
So we must recognize that the homemakers play an important role.
Mm.
Of course, I'm not saying everybody must be a homemaker.
Yeah,
there
of course,
are people
of
who choose
it's not for anyone,
to be
everyone,
career.
Yeah.
Now, if you recognize that, this group, they will be quite happy to have three children.
Really?
Provided it's not an economic burden.
Mm, of course.
Some countries will give quite generous allowance to the mother.
Mm, okay.
So that they can have children without a financial burden.
Mm.
So, but sadly, the financial incentive, the baby bonus, favor those high-income owners.
Really, during that era, during your, like, 4 decades ago?
Yeah, 4 decades ago. Up to now,
yeah,
up to now.
Up to now, really? Up to now?
Because it still says that it will come in the form of a tax rebate.
Okay, fair.
I think that was mistaken.
Okay.
If you actually give adequate allowance for the mother to take care of the children, it will not solve the problem totally, but it will solve the problem to some significant extent.
So you're saying instead of, my view on this like children thing is not very well informed because I make memes, right? But you're saying that even till today, the current policy is not very favorable of people from all backgrounds to have children.
It's, if you want people to have children, you must make it possible for homemakers, people who are not working, to have children, and the large part of the cost should be borne by the country, by the state.
By the country.
By the state. Maybe you either give the mother an allowance or you make free medical care for children. So that it doesn't become a burden.
Yes, okay, I see. So, what do you think they are doing now that is not adequate, if you could tell the public? Because actually, not many people are aware of the current policies and what they entail.
They don't provide an allowance to the mother. Or whatever they provide is not enough.
It's like inadequate.
Much inadequate. Mm. Because they don't recognize that the stay-at-home mother is...
It's a job
very,
role.
Yeah, it's an important part of the workforce of a country.
Oh, okay. So you're saying that there's not enough recognition given to stay-at-home mothers as recognizing their role as actually being an active part of the workforce of a country.
So you can't expect a career woman to also be producing children because it's too much for them.
Unless there are some high-powered CEO, right?
But that's the minority.
Yeah, yeah.
We're talking about the majority of the people. Mm. Now, in every cohort, a year, you have people from those who are career-minded, but you also have a large part who are
stay-at-home
mother to raise children.
Okay.
That's my mother, and that's my wife.
Yes.
And just recognize that these people are quite important.
As
and
well.
It's not just my mother and my wife, but a large group of people of that
group, right? Yeah. They have contributed to Singapore as well, that you feel have been grossly under-recognized.
Yes, I think the government policy of just saying, let's give more incentive to working mothers, graduate mothers, was very mistaken. And it has not been reversed.
It has not been reversed. Yeah, okay. So if you were elected president, Mr. Tan, other than, improving this, which in your view is... lopsided policy, what else will you do for mothers that choose to be stay-at-home mothers? That means have a very traditional role in the family.
Well, this is not the role of the president. Mm-hmm. There's a government who decides this policy.
Okay.
But I will certainly give them my views.
Okay, so you feel that the role of the president is to
advise
additional insights.
Yeah, I think that's a very useful role. And I also have the role is also to help people make the change. Let me explain. We have policies that have been stuck with us for 4 decades.
Stuck.
That means has been, this was the policy up to now.
Right. It has not really evolved with the times.
It's minor changes, but the root cause is not recognized.
The root cause is not recognized.
The root cause is, we want everybody to go into the workforce or something like that. Eh?
Right.
We want all the women to go into the workforce. That's wrong.
That's wrong.
You must have maybe 50% in the workforce and 50% stay at home.
Okay, this is a bold statement, Mr. Tan.
Sorry?
It's a bold statement because some people feel that nowadays, like the Barbie movie, for example, all women should be career-minded and maybe...
I think that is wrong. That's my view. Huh? Yeah. I think that's wrong. The society is better if...
if there's
course,
a balance.
In the old days, it was... 100% are homemakers and only the men work.
Okay.
Now you don't want to have 100% of women all working with the men. No? Right. You want to have that. I'm still quite moderate. I say half-half.
Half-half.
Or maybe I would prefer more towards homemakers.
Okay.
Than to.
So I also need to ask you this difficult question because our audience will definitely have this. There'll be people who comment in the comment section that this view of that you hold of women ideally, a percentage of them being homemakers is, to put it bluntly, they'll say that this view is outdated. What are your thoughts about that?
No, if you look upon homemakers as somebody valuable, and you pay them, give them the recognition that they are doing something valuable, it actually makes a lot of sense. I find that the mother can take care of children better than foreign maids.
I see.
If you have mothers working, and not many of them are working in high paying jobs. Some are just working in retail shops and just in the service industry.
Or maybe even grab food.
Yeah. So it's not necessarily that they are all in high paying jobs. So if you recognize that, if you tell them you got a choice to be a mother, and you actually can earn enough to take care of your children,
you become a very attractive
position,
right?
And that's much better for a country.
For the country.
Yeah. Right now that we have low birth rate for 3-4 decades, that we have to depend upon foreigners coming in. I think that is mistaken.
It's the root problems.
Just now I said that. My role is to help people make the change. Because the ministers will not dare to make a change because it might not work. Then they will lose their job. They lose the election. So therefore, they take an easy way out. I don't change. It was like that, you know. Who wants to make a change?
You're saying we are afraid of change because it's seen as very risky.
It's risky and you might lose your job.
For a person's position.
Yeah. So therefore, if I'm the president, I would say, if you make this change, I share your responsibility.
And you share their responsibility.
If it doesn't
work, guys, we both go down with the ship.
No. If the thing doesn't work, you can point your finger and say, Mr. Tan suggested that.
Okay,
you know?
That's fine. That's fine. You don't mind sharing the blame.
No, that's a job of a leader.
A leader.
In order to encourage people to make a change, you must be prepared to accept the
feedback.
No, you must be prepared to accept
the end result.
But the leader has something very important. The leader has the authority to reverse the decision.
I see.
And that's what I've been doing.
In corporate life.
In my corporate life, we make bold changes.
Yes.
My department manager will not dare to take that risk. I said, I share it with you. It's partly my responsibility. When the thing doesn't work, it come back to me. I got the authority to change, modify it.
To pivot again.
To modify it. And then after a few rounds of modification, it works.
So what actually you are saying that one of the tenets of good balance management is that as a country, we need to be able to reclaim the confidence to make changes, to be comfortable with certain changes not working out initially, and then to take that feedback and keep tweaking till we find the right solution. But you're saying that if we do not even take the first step to make any changes or bold moves due to fear, then we are forever stuck in the past, which is even worse.
That is a good description.
Ah, see, Mr. Tan, I fully understand where you're coming from. And would you say that it's fair to say that the reason why over time, for example, for the stay-at-home mother's issue, right, is that society has actually lost sight of the value of mothers and only place obsession over career and income generating positions?
I think to some extent that is true. Okay. Because the stay-at-home mothers are considered as not contributing to the economy.
To the economy in terms of money.
In terms of GDP measurement.
In terms of numbers.
But if they do get an allowance and it's counted as part of the...
I see. Part of the economic
growth.
And their tax on that allowance.
Either their tax... that's fine, you know?
Okay.
You know, I tell people, everybody should be taxed.
Yeah.
Even the low income people should be taxed.
Okay.
Provided the income is high enough to be taxed, you know?
So there's some meat to tax.
So you must raise people's income to a high, adequate level. Then you tax them 10%, it's okay, you know?
Yeah, they're fine, they're
because
fine.
Because if my salary increased by 30% and you take away 10%, I still got a 20% increase.
Yeah, yeah.
So therefore, I say paying tax is unnecessary, but I don't like GST.
You don't like GST?
GST is very bad.
Very bad.
Because every expenditure has to be counted and accounted for. You can see every transaction is counted and counted again.
Yeah.
You know, it's very wasteful.
Wasteful?
Very wasteful to be used to be taxing GST. I've been against GST.
You've been against GST?
I've been against GST. I say waive GST if you want to get your revenue, get it from payroll tax. Everybody, payroll, government take a 10%, take a 8% on payroll tax. At least it's once a month you take away. Everything you buy, you got small little bits and pieces tax. GST is a very wasteful tax.
Very wasteful.
And then you've got people doing accounting.
Very stressful.
And it's, well, I run a business, I know. I have to spend time to just do the accounting, you know.
For the GST.
And then you have to pay accountant to do it.
Even on a $5 copy, you have to have GST.
Yeah. No, it's very, very...
wasteful.
Very wasteful.
So you'd rather that the government take across the board standardized income percentage tax?
Let's say payroll tax is one way.
Okay, okay.
But of course, income tax is okay, but you give people enough salary, you know, just raise the salary for everybody, minimum wages, and take away your 10% or take away your 8 or 9% on top of it, and do leave them something extra. You raise by 20%, take away 10, it's okay, you know.
Then of course the critics will say that it is really impossible to raise everyone's salary. How would you work around that?
It's possible. No,
it's possible.
Of course it's possible.
You feel it's possible? And how do you think you will effect such change to make it possible to raise everyone's salary across the board?
Well, I would discuss this concept with the government.
Mm-hmm.
If I were the prime minister, I would take a lead to implement this. What I'm worried is Singapore is doing things quite wastefully. Because we do our time doing rubbish things, you know?
Rubbish things?
Yeah, all this GST accounting.
Take out
a lot of manpower and then you take out a lot of stress, you know?
Okay.
Because if I don't report my GST properly, the tax will come after me. FBI, open up!
Knock on your door.
It's quite counterproductive.
Counterproductive.
So you don't have these kind of things. You can get your revenue somewhere else. And the government already got plenty of revenue from the sale of land.
Enough.
It's more than enough. And the GST is totally unnecessary. I hold a view for three decades, 30 years.
And it's not changed.
And every time they increase by 1%,
yeah,
the prices go up 5%. I said,
oh, because the business is trying to offset the...
Yeah.
The additional cost to maintain this upkeep, administrative upkeep of GST.
Well, the recent 1% increase, many people say the prices of food have gone up 5 to 10%.
Mm.
Even the coffee has gone up 5 to 10%. It's very counterproductive. It's quite wasteful.
And Mr. Tan, what words of wisdom do you have for the young people that are entering the workforce in these uncertain times of AI, you know, insecure jobs out in the market?
Okay, I don't know whether my own experience will be helpful. Most people will say, these are what I want.
Mm.
My experience is quite different.
Mm.
I took the job in NTUC, not because I want it,
okay,
but because they want me.
Because they want you.
No, right? And I don't impose any condition.
Ah,
so okay, when they offer me a salary of $3,000 to run a big company a month, you know?
A month, right, yeah.
I said, okay. I accept it. Of course, my salary grow with time. Over time, the company grow big. But when they first
approach
offered
you
the job to me, the company was not wealthy. They were, the financials were...
It was still a modest beginning.
Very modest.
Very,
you know,
modest. Yeah.
Yeah. So I said, okay, you know, that means I put the interest of the company ahead of my own interest.
Oh, so that's your secret to career success. You decided to, even before you were of a very... prestigious stature as a CEO, how you got to where you are as a CEO is you put the interest of the company above your own preferences.
Yeah. And I do what the company needs.
What the company needs.
Yeah. So it's not that what I need. Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
And this is also my attitude towards society.
Mm.
The society needs certain people to do certain things. If you put your interest above the society, then you are being selfish.
Mm.
And of course, selfish people looking after their own interests
will not go far.
No, they will go to a certain extent.
To a certain extent.
But I would prefer to put the wider interest above my personal interest. And then as the society grows or the company grows, I'm part of it.
You will get your... Justified rewards, right?
That's my attitude.
Okay.
And so most people that I know, their approach is quite different.
Quite different. So that is your secret to career success that you would like to impart to our audience. And
in fact, I will come and say, don't look for the job you want. Look for a company that wants you.
Look for a company that wants you. What if no company wants you?
No, most companies will need people.
Will need people.
And it could be the most difficult job because nobody wants a job. Nobody wants a job because... But your boss needs you.
Ah, okay.
And then you get a much more opportunity
when
your boss needs you.
Then what about the young people in the job market now that they say that they feel unwanted, unloved and unneeded and they feel not needed by any company?
I think
they feel disillusioned.
No, I think if they adopt my approach, where you say I will work for the company that needs me most.
Yeah, according to like the current market.
Even so, you know, there are certain jobs that nobody wants because it's difficult.
It's difficult. Yes.
Take the job.
Take
the
job
because
you have no competition.
That's precisely.
Precisely, right?
You got no competition.
Yeah, blue ocean strategy.
And then you got a job, and the opportunity will come
over time.
Not too long.
Not too long, right? Because nobody wants that job. It's too hard, right? Yeah.
But most people I know will not accept that job. That's my advice.
That's your advice.
That's been my philosophy all my life.
All your life. Yeah. So you're saying
even now the presidential job is just the same.
Yeah. It's a difficult job.
No, most people say, why are you going to take this job and disrupt your personal life?
Yes.
You can really enjoy yourself.
Yeah,
no?
You have your coffee.
But I say, and the freedom.
To, the freedom.
Okay. But I say, if the country needs me,
if a duty calls,
If I can do something about bringing down the cost of living, and so on, if I can put an influence,
yeah.
So I said, I will give it a try.
This is what you want to give a try. So, guys, in short, Mr. Tan's philosophy is that in life we should maybe certain times not aim for what we want, but to look at a wider perspective
what
other people need. Yeah. The secret to getting what you want is to fulfill the needs of others first. And I think on that note, this has been a very enjoyable conversation with you, Mr. Tan. We will, of course, wish our guest all the best in his upcoming endeavors to be the next president of Singapore. Thank you, Mr. Tan, for coming on this podcast. Thank you, guys. And that has been yet another episode of the Singaplex After Office Hours podcast. And if you like this episode or if you like any of our previous episodes, please hit the notification bell. Drop a good comment below to encourage our podcast guest in his presidential pursuit. Like, subscribe, and we are on all platforms, Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, and of course here on YouTube. And till next time, see you. Bye-bye.